Good afternoon, everyone, and I want to say heartfelt thanks to all of you that have taken time out of what I know, especially this time of year here at Hofstra Law, our very demanding schedule. So thank you so much, but I know that you will not be disappointed. This is a very prestigious lecture that is going to be given today, and it was started years and years ago. And I know it's very important to the Kaplan family, but it's also become very important to Hofstra Law because we have had some of the very finest members of the state and federal judiciary. Those individuals who have made a difference to the legal system, to the rule of law. But most importantly, individuals that have taken cases on a case-by-case basis to show what being a judge is really all about. And it really is all about searching out justice. So the woman that has been chosen this year to deliver this very prestigious Kaplan lecture is someone I have known for many years and I hold in the highest of regard. Judge Preska, many of you know her, many of you have heard of her. She is one of those special people. To know her is to love her. There is no doubt about that. Whether you speak to any of her former law clerks, whether you speak to any of the clerks in the court, whether you speak to lawyers who appear in front of her, anybody who's had an opportunity to work with her, to be her colleague, to be her friend. Judge Preska was appointed to the United States District Court as a judge in the Southern District of New York in 1992. Now that's after, number one, she graduated from a college not very dissimilar to my own, the College of St. Rose in Albany, New York, but then had a very distinguished career at Fordham, you know, at Fordham Law School. And she then went on to get her Master's of Laws as well, from NYU, I'm sorry. Following graduation, she did the big firm thing, and as she told me this morning, she learned a lot from that experience, and she thinks it's a good experience for many individuals to have. But I think she was truly ready for what I think was her and is her calling. And she sees being a member of the judiciary as a vocation, not as a job. She has held many titles, but to her it's not about titles. Being a judge or having a degree of experience and also a degree of effects on individuals' lives is much more important to her than any title that she has held. One of her former law clerks, we are very, very lucky to have here at Hofstra as one of our associate counsels in general counsel's office here at the university. I have had the absolute pleasure of working with her. And so what I did when I saw that Jennifer Mullins had been one of Judge Preska's clerks, I reached out to a number of other individuals, Judge Preska doesn't know this, who I know Judge Preska very, very well. And this was the common theme that went through all of those discussions. No one, absolutely no one, was surprised by her many successes. She is a role model, and you will see that today, and mentor for so many. And I am so glad that so many of our students are here to see her and hear her and watch just this fabulous, wonderful demeanor that to me shows what being a true professional is all about. They all emphasized her true belief in public service. And they said that it really becomes apparent the first day you work with her, even in the courtroom or in chambers, because she refers to the people who appear in front of her and the attorneys as well as her clients. And she believes in her clients because she believes that she owes them a duty of service. She was a great chief judge. I can't even believe she's not the chief judge anymore. To me, she's still the chief judge. She'll always be the chief judge. She's a fabulous, beloved chief judge. I can't believe the time has gone by and she's passed the torch. But most importantly, she extends the hand of friendship to anyone who needs that hand. And I am very proud that she will be delivering this year's Kaplan Lecture at Hofstra Law School. Thank you.
And by the way, ladies and gentlemen, to know her is to love her. Here she is. It's a great honor to deliver the Howard and Iris Kaplan Lecture and to join the list of distinguished prior lecturers. As you probably know, Howard Kaplan was not a graduate of Hofstra Law School. Indeed, the law school had not yet been established when he graduated from law school in the 40s, right, Tony? In the 40s?
Yeah.
But despite not having attended Hofstra Law School, Howard Kaplan became a very successful lawyer, specializing in trust and estate work. Following his untimely death in 1979, one of his grateful clients offered to fund projects in his memory. And so Iris and their son Tony, Tony, where are you? Thank you. Iris and Tony thought about what to do and established this wonderful lecture series that has been graced by justices of the Supreme Court, state court chief justices, and judges of the circuit courts of appeals. Tony, of course, owes a great deal to Hofstra Law School. Not only did he graduate from Hofstra in 1983 and go on to a clerkship with Judge Wilfred Feinberg of the Second Circuit, the first Kaplan lecturer, but Tony met his wife, Marilyn Beth Fagelson, class of 1983 graduate of Hofstra, right here at the law school. Tony, it's an honor to have you here today. Thank you for being present. I only wish I could have met your parents. Alas, I was too late. But on the other hand, I was too early to attend this fine law school. When I was thinking about going to law school, Nelson Rockefeller was governor, and this law school was under construction. After the construction, of course, we have the beautiful Maurice A. Dean School of Law building, of which Hofstra is so justly proud. When I was in law school, Hofstra had a charter faculty of 6. Today, Hofstra boasts an accomplished, active, full-time faculty of 46, 6 visiting professors, and nearly 60 adjunct professors. The initial entering class at Hofstra was 83 students, 68 men and 15 women. Today, Hofstra's student body is 1,100 strong, closely balanced between men and women. The catalog for Hofstra's 1971-72 school year lists 30 courses on offer, 17 of which were required. Today, Hofstra offers 200 upper-level courses, 8 areas of concentration, and a well-recognized clinical program. Tuition for the 71-72 school year was $2,000. Current tuition is $55,000. At the outset, Hofstra had one student journal, the Law Review. Today, the law school boasts 5 student journals. When I graduated from law school in 1973, the world was also a very different place. That year, President Nixon had just been inaugurated after a landslide victory. today. We've just finished a presidential campaign unlike any ever seen before, including the first presidential debate of the 2016 season, right here at Hofstra on September 26. On June 4, 1973, a patent was issued for something called an ATM. Of course, we 73 graduates have never seen one. Today, there are some 3 million ATMs in service in the country. On April 2 of 1973, the first computerized legal research system was launched, Lexis, offering full text searches of only New York and Ohio cases. Of course, none of us had ever heard of this or seen it, and just like this photo of a Hofstra student of the same era, we persisted in using books for our research for many years. Today, of course, online legal research is the standard, and I'm sure few of you can imagine doing legal research using only books. There are unfortunately some similarities between then and now. In May of 1973, the unlawful behavior surrounding the break-in at the Watergate Hotel was just coming to light. In the past few years, our state and our city have been burdened by a rash of official corruption convictions, many of which were in my court. On April 4 of 1973, the World Trade Center opened for business in Lower Manhattan. Today, we still mourn the thousands who were lost there on 9/11, but we've opened One World Trade in its place. On March 29 of 1973, the last American soldier left Vietnam after over 8 years of U.S. involvement and the loss of some 58,000 American lives. Today, we are fighting a foe seeking to reestablish the caliphate that ran from Spain to Turkey. You also won't be surprised to learn that in 1973, when I graduated from law school, I was different too. While I'm sure I knew there was a federal district court in Manhattan, I certainly did not know the chief judge, then David Edelstein. Today, I just finished being the chief judge for 7 years. For sure, I did not know in 1973 that the federal court in Manhattan was the first federal court to sit in the entire country, the mother court. The first session of our court was held on the first Tuesday of November, 1789, preceding the Supreme Court by several months. And no, it is not true that there was no reason for that appellate court to sit until the mother court began committing errors. The cases heard in our court in the early years, in 1973 and today, reflect the changes in our country over the centuries. At the outset, the mother court was primarily an admiralty court. For example, a French frigate captured the Catherine, a British vessel, in the waters off New Jersey, and towed her back to New York as a prize. Judge James Duane, a former mayor of the city of New York and the first judge to sit in the mother court, held that the seizure took place in neutral waters, and therefore the British owners were entitled to their property back. Admiralty cases have remained a large part of our docket, and we've seen cases involving the Titanic and the Lusitania. In my now distant student days of the 70s, the country was in the midst of a great social upheaval fueled by Watergate and the Vietnam War. People wrote about their complaints, they spoke out about them, they burned flags in protest, and they wore what they considered to be protest gear. When the authorities, whether it be the state or colleges and universities, tried to suppress that speech, the students sued. In numerous court opinions relying on the First Amendment, the free speechers almost invariably prevailed. Courts held that wearing black armbands, peace signs, anti-war t-shirts, and burning flags was speech protected by the First Amendment, no matter how heartily other people disagreed. There was also the great Pentagon Papers case, where the mother court's own Judge Murray Gerfein, and eventually the Supreme Court, upheld the right of two great newspapers to publish material that might embarrass the government, a triumph for free speech. Today, however, the tables are turned, and the importance of speech seems to be lost on campuses. In November of 2015, in response to a controversial article in a student satirical newspaper, The Koala, administrators at the University of California, San Diego, publicly condemned the newspaper's offensive and hurtful language. Remember, this is a college satirical newspaper. Its very purpose is to be offensive. The same day, the student government voted to strip funding from all student media publications. And worse yet, this was the second time in 5 years the student government had done it, specifically to censure the Koala. Also in 2015, the Wesleyan Argus published an op-ed piece critical of the Black Lives Matter movement. In response, Wesleyan students demanded that the newspaper be defunded and that the Argus's budget be divided up among the other student publications according to the popularity of the publications. Were it still extant, the Soviet Union would be so proud. My favorite, of course, is the Yale Halloween fiasco. You will recall that the Yale Intercultural Affairs Center felt the need to caution students about being thoughtful about the cultural implications of their Halloween costumes. Erica Christakis, associate master at Silliman, responded in an email lamenting that we seem to be afraid that college students are unable to decide how to dress themselves on Halloween, and questioning the consequences of an institutional, which is to say bureaucratic and administrative exercise of implied control over college students. She said, is there no room anymore for a child or a young person to be a little bit obnoxious, a little bit inappropriate, or provocative, or yes, offensive? American universities were once a safe space, not only for maturation, she said, but also for a certain regressive or even transgressive experience. Increasingly, it seems, they have become places of censure and prohibition. She and her husband, the master at Silliman, suggested instead, quote, if you don't like a costume someone is wearing, look the other way, or tell them you don't like it. She said, talk to each other. Free speech and the ability to tolerate offense are hallmarks of a free and open society. In response, the supposedly well-educated students at this top university accused the Christakis's of failing to create a safe space for Silliman students and demanded that they resign or that the university remove them, all for uttering the apparently unspeakable thought that college students might be able to choose their own Halloween costumes. This February, former Breitbart contributor Milo Yiannopoulos, a self-proclaimed free speech fundamentalist who disagrees with, among every other things, feminism, Islam, political correctness, was scheduled to speak at Berkeley, the flagship school of the University of California. Large protests gave way to violence and the destruction of property, including the setting of fires, throwing rocks, bricks, and Molotov cocktails, and smashing in windows. The student newspaper reported that the police used rubber bullets and tear gas in an attempt to disperse the crowd of about 1,500. Based on security concerns, the speech was canceled and Yiannopoulos taken off campus. The university estimated $100,000 in damage to university property, and the downtown businesses had 10 businesses damaged. Apparently, the Berkeley people do not believe in that age-old legal maxim, sticks and stones can break your bones, but words can never hurt you. In March, Charles Murray, a writer and scholar at the Conservative American Enterprise Institute, was scheduled to speak at Middlebury College in Vermont. His statements about race and intelligence in particular had garnered extensive criticism. When he arrived at the Middlebury venue, most of the audience stood, turned their backs to him, and started chanting so he couldn't be heard. Eventually, after 20 minutes, the event was rescheduled, was moved to another room, and live-streamed into the auditorium. Showing a great deal of maturity, the students then set off the fire alarms so that Murray could not be heard. When the professor who conducted the interview, Professor Allison Stranger, Murray and an administrator left through the back door, 20 or 30 protesters started shoving and pushing them. And even with two campus security guards, one of the protesters grabbed Professor Stranger by the hair, twisted her neck, sending her to the hospital. As Laura McKenna wrote in The Atlantic, Murray spoke at Middlebury 10 years ago without incident. Now, his presence on campus spurred chants, shoves, and a concussion. In the last 2 years, I know you've all read that Police Commissioner Ray Kelly was shouted down and prevented from speaking at Brown. Former Secretary of State, now Provost at Stanford, Condoleezza Rice, withdrew from speaking at Rutgers because of protests. And even at Fordham University, right here in New York at the center of the known universe, Ann Coulter, perhaps a bit more provocative a speaker than Commissioner Kelly or Secretary Rice, but certainly an established pundit, was unceremoniously disinvited from speaking on campus. Just 2 weeks ago, Heather McDonald of the City Journal was prevented from speaking at Claremont McKenna College in California for fear her new book, The War on Cops, might be too difficult to discuss. Not a good state of affairs. But Daniel Henninger noted last month in the Wall Street Journal, quote, "A few days after the Murray incident, something extraordinary happened. 40 Middlebury professors from many disciplines signed a strong statement supporting free inquiry on campus. The number of signatures of professors grew to 80, and some of those professors didn't have tenure, by the way. Henninger called the Middlebury statement an important event, noting that, quote, it doesn't merely defend free speech and inquiry. It explicitly rejects arguments of the left justifying speech suppression, such as their notion that certain ideas are in themselves a form of violence. The Middlebury dissenters noted, quote, exposure to controversial points of view is not violence. Similarly, the University of Chicago sent a letter to its entering class of 2020, noting the school's commitment to free inquiry and expression. It said, members of our community are encouraged to speak, write, listen, challenge, and learn without fear of censorship. Civility and mutual respect are vital to all of us, and freedom of expression does not mean the freedom to harass or threaten others. Even as far back as 2011, the William F. Buckley Jr. Program was established at Yale to promote intellectual diversity on campus. Exhibiting Buckley's legendary sense of humor, the Buckley program recently instituted the Disinvitation Dinner, honoring those like Commissioner Kelly, Secretary Rice, and Heather McDonald who have been disinvited from speaking on campuses. But lest you think the tide has turned, a national poll of college students conducted last year by the Buckley program reported that 72% of students said that they support disciplinary action for any student or faculty member on campus who uses language that is considered racist, sexist, homophobic, or otherwise offensive. As Jenny Moon knows, if that were the rule, my husband would have no chance. You know my husband. Why are these contemporary assaults on free speech so troubling? I suggest to you that it is because the silencing of speech with which we disagree is against the very essence of America. Our country is like none other on this planet. America is the only country bound together not by ethnicity, religion, or geography, but by ideas. Our founders brought forth a country based on the idea that the people had certain inalienable rights, and when they went about enumerating just what those rights were, freedom of speech was first. And our founders intended those inalienable rights to be stronger in this new country than in the old world. As Justice Hugo Black wrote in Bridges v. California, no purpose in ratifying the Bill of Rights was clearer than that of securing for the people of the United States much greater freedom of religion, expression, assembly, and petition than the people of Great Britain had ever enjoyed. Professor Frederick Schnauer has written, "The American First Amendment, as authoritatively interpreted, remains a recalcitrant outlier to the growing international understanding of what freedom of expression entails. In numerous dimensions, the American approach is exceptional, in generally being stronger than that represented by an emerging multinational consensus." And Harvard Law professor, formerly Chief Justice of the Massachusetts Supreme Judicial Court, and United States Solicitor General Charles Freed summed it up beautifully by saying, "American law is the most libertarian and speech protective of any liberal democratic regime." But the founders foresaw danger even in this great freedom. Perhaps presciently, James Madison observed in a letter to Thomas Jefferson, "In our government, the real power lies in the majority of the community, and the invasion of private rights is chiefly to be apprehended not from the acts of government contrary to the sense of its constituents, but from acts of the government, acts in which the government is the mere instrument of a majority number of its constituents." He referred, of course, to the tyranny of the majority. The Supreme Court has repeatedly recognized the right of our citizens to engage in speech that the majority finds despicable, or I guess I should say deplorable. For example, in American National Socialist Party of America against the Village of Skokie, the court in 1977 upheld the right of neo-Nazis to march through a predominantly Jewish section of Skokie, Illinois. In 2011, the court upheld the right of the reprehensible Westboro Baptist Church to protest at the funerals of servicemen and women killed in the line of duty, screaming such things as "God loves dead soldiers," "Thank God for dead soldiers," and "God hates fags." As the Supreme Court has recognized, the cherished right to say things that the majority disagree with is in America's DNA. Remember that a century ago, the majority saw no reason why women should vote. In my lifetime, the majority saw no reason why blacks and whites should drink from the same water fountain, attend the same schools, or sit at the same lunch counters. So my message to you today is a simple one. Reject the tyranny of the majority. As Hofstra-trained lawyers, you should be most wary of groupthink. You've been taught here at Hofstra to think critically and to weigh the evidence and the logical inferences to be drawn from that evidence. That's the cornerstone of our profession, our Rosetta Stone. Why should we surrender our critical thinking to the transient, politically correct waves of the day? Why should we not want to hear two or more sides of an issue, of every issue? And worst of all, why should we want to silence voices with whom we disagree or allow others to do so? Such suppression of speech is antithetical to the uniquely idea in America that the antidote to bad speech is more speech. And so from the vantage point of 44 years out of law school and almost 25 years on the bench, I say to you, maintain an open mind and utilize the critical thinking skills that you've learned here at Hofstra in making your decisions. Make your decisions based on the facts and the evidence, not groupthink. As Mayor Michael Bloomberg said last year at Michigan, in a global economy and a democratic society, an open mind is the most valuable asset you can possess. Of course, it being a university commencement in America in the year of 2016, he was roundly booed. I'd like to give thanks to Courtney Selby, the Associate Dean for Informational Services, Director of the Law Library, and Associate Professor of Law, for providing the wonderful Hofstra historical material. Thank you for the honor of delivering the Kaplan lecture. I shall always remember it. And thank you again, Tony, for being present.
Refreshments will be served.
Yes.
Does she have time for questions?
Judge Preska, do you have time for questions?
Certainly.
Certainly. Thank you, Professor.
Well,
I didn't see who it was. Yes, sir.
I would start by asking about the tension between our electoral process and free speech. It is true that that we have a marketplace and that the antidote for lies are counter-truths. But in the last election cycle, it would seem as though there was a dissemination of a lot of untruth and no time to actually counter the untruth with truth. And I'm wondering how the dissemination of and fabrication of facts can be dealt with if we're to accept the traditional understanding we've had about the marketplace of ideas.
Well, first I would say that who's going to be in charge of figuring out what's a fabrication and what's true and what's false? As we know, there's been a lot of criticism of the fact checkers. So it is not the American way to have an information czar. And again, I go to the uniquely American view that the antidote for bad speech is more speech. And it was talked about constantly, and that's what we do. The timing factor, that's the way life is these days. Everything is very quick. Of course, I watch Howie Kurtz on the weekend doing media buzz.
Would your view change if it turned out that this was foreign interference in an election? and that there were thousands of trolls, for example, who were...
Thousands of what, sir?
Hackers or trolls who were actually disseminating false information.
Who's going to be in charge? Who's going to be in charge in deciding what's correct and what isn't correct? It is only the marketplace of ideas that can sift through all of the noise. Now, there might have been a lot of noise out there, but that's the sign of our times. Who else? Yes, sir.
So much of your talk was actually not about free speech in the First Amendment sense, but about universities. And universities don't actually operate on a basis of the antidote to false speech is more speech. We don't allow
Much is the pity, I would say.
Well, I'm not sure that we could get much done if we had to give tenure to people regardless of their views and regardless of the quality of their work. I think we would have a hard time teaching if we allowed science and non-science to have equal status. It'd be extremely difficult to run a biology class if you have to give equal time to people who just made up facts. And universities don't work that way. In fact, no industry that relies on actual knowledge and actual information offers equal access. So I wonder if you could talk for a moment about the free speech implications of some of the examples you gave, a number of which were along a scenario of an invited speaker paid a large amount of money to come in and present a controversial view. And then other people who were not in a position to make decisions like inviting people or paying them a lot of money, speaking in opposition. And I gathered that you didn't like the speaking in opposition, and I'm wondering why is that less valuable than the original invitation, given especially that nobody has a right to be invited to offer a commencement speech.
Yes, sir. Several points. First of all, with respect to tenure and academic freedom and that sort of thing, actually, I don't know if Judge Prudenti knows this. When I was a practicing lawyer, I actually represented Columbia University in a variety of these things. So I know how this goes. On your biology or science issue, first of all, it's not equal access. Nobody is suggesting that it has to be equal access. Certainly in an area like biology or the hard sciences where there is generally an objective right and wrong, obviously departments have the right to make a decision on tenure based on whatever the person's research is. What I would suggest to you is that there is more of a need on American campuses for a diversity of intellectual views. And we've all read a lot about how completely left-thinking most faculty in most universities are. I would suggest that it is more of a service to our students to expose our students to different opinions and teach them to think critically. There was one other point at the end, which I've now forgotten.
Speech and protesters.
Oh, the point is, my point is, don't suppress speech you disagree with. That's the whole point. The people who are invited to speak have been invited to speak. Let them speak, and then you want to have your protest. But don't break windows, and don't prevent the speaker from speaking. That's my point. Two sides are always better than one. Three sides, let's do it. But don't prevent the speaker from speaking. And I don't care how much they pay them, actually. Who else? Yes, sir.
Did you use the example of the Westboro Baptist Church, which was a great example of speech that most of us are deeply offended by. There is, and you also mentioned, separately you mentioned that the antidote to speech we don't like is potentially more speech and having that dialogue. And there's just a beautiful coda to that story because a bunch of motorcyclists started going together following the Westboro Baptist Church to these funerals, interceding with their motorcycles, nothing physical, nothing violent, just interposing their motorcycles, and large American flags. And so the people who are mourning the loss of their loved one never even saw the Westboro Baptist Church. And it actually brought out people doing beautiful things.
Perfect. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. I appreciate your thought-provoking presentation. I think, though, that a lot of students in college are engaging in critical thinking, and that they're not. This is not about groupthink, and it's not about what has been always called political correctness. I think what happens is, particularly in the culture, the current culture in which we live, where people have finally begun to understand the history of slavery in this country, the history of oppression of women, students are actually speaking out, and they're thinking critically, and they really don't want to any longer have corporate sponsorship of, you know, various people who are going to come speak. So I don't like the violence. I think that is wrong. But I don't think that there's anything inherently anti-speech about the fact that these students have actually thought very critically, and they're beyond groupthink when they are protesting people like Yiannopoulos or Ann Coulter, or people who are engaging in alternative facts. I don't think that when you, as other people have said, when you have facts on one side, for instance, in terms of climate change, the idea that you would have someone speaking about the fact that, yes, we have global warming, and then two other people who may be paid to come to speak about the fact there isn't any climate change, that you necessarily have to support those other voices.
I'm not asking people to support them. I'm asking that they be listened to and not prevented from speaking. And, you know, I won't even go to where the facts are and who's the decider of what the facts are. But the point is that a variety of voices should be heard and not prevented from speaking. That's my only point. I think Judge Prudenti wants us to go to lunch.